some of a little more time to get on into the house of God. Amen. Hebrews, the sixth chapter. Hebrews, the sixth chapter. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hebrews, the sixth chapter. We're going to deal with four key scriptures in that particular chapter. Hebrews, the sixth chapter, verse 20. And Hebrews, the seventh chapter, verses 1 through 3. It's Hebrews, the sixth chapter, verse 20. And Hebrews, the seventh chapter, verses 1 through 3. Yes, Lord. Right behind, right before the book of James. Yes, Lord. When you had it, could you please say amen?
Amen.
Whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus, made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. We go to chapter 7, verse 1 through 3. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace, without father, without mother, without descent or descended, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abided a priest continually or forever. And saints of God, I want to deal with on tonight, Jesus, your great high priest, after the order of Melchizedek. Jesus, your great high priest, after the order of Melchizedek. Jesus, somebody say Jesus.
Jesus,
your great high priest, after the order of Melchizedek. Yes. Now, saints of God, we have constantly been dealing with God the Father.
Yes.
We've been dealing with the different names of God the Father.
Yes.
God, different attributes.
Yes.
But tonight I want to deal with the Son. I want to deal with Jesus, our high priest.
Yes.
Now, saints of God, we need to get an understanding about the Godhead. Because a lot of us think that Jesus and the Father is the same person, and they're not. Is what we need to understand. Now, we are not Jehovah Witnesses. Now, when I say that now, I have to say that in a way that you don't think that we don't serve Jehovah. But we are not Jehovah Witnesses. The difference between us and Jehovah Witnesses is that Jehovah Witnesses don't believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead in his body. They believe that he rose from the dead just in spirit. Well, we know that's wrong, because when Jesus rose again from the dead, he walked in the room and he showed them his hands where the nails was at. Then he showed them his feet where the nail print was at. Then he showed them his side. Then he sat down and ate with them. Then Jesus told them, he said, look at my hands and look at my feet. He said, because the spirit don't have flesh and blood, what you see. So they throw that out the door. And a Jehovah Witness, they don't believe in a Trinity. Do you hear me, saints of God? They don't believe in the Trinity. They don't believe that Jesus was there with the Father in the beginning. But we see in John, he said, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And the Bible said the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Talking about Jesus Christ. So that's the difference between us and Jehovah Witnesses. All of us serve Jehovah. But when it comes down to Jesus, they don't believe that he got up in his body.
Yes.
Do you hear me? His body had to come out that grave in order for us to be saved.
Right.
So that's the difference now. They still serve Jehovah, but they don't believe the same thing that we believe about King Jesus.
Yes.
That's what separates us.
Mm-hmm.
They don't believe in a Trinity. They don't believe that Jesus was there with the Father. They believe that Jesus was created.
Mm-hmm.
They believe that God created Jesus. Well, we know better than that because Jesus said, I am the Alpha and Omega. Yes. I am the beginning and I am the last.
Yes.
Do you hear me? He said, before Abraham was, he said, I am. Which I was there in the beginning.
Yes.
So Jesus wasn't created by God. He was always there in the beginning.
Yes.
So I just wanted to throw that out there. Somebody said sidebar. It's just a sidebar. I just want to kind of hit on that because sometimes we have a question. Okay, what's the difference between us and Jehovah Witnesses?
Yes.
Well, that's the difference. That's a big difference.
Yes.
Because we know that Jesus got up in spirit and in body.
Yes.
Do you hear me? That he's sitting on the right hand side of God with the same prince in his hand that he had when he was on earth.
Yes.
The same prince in his feet.
Yes.
In the same hole in his side.
Yes.
As we're going to get ready to see, because this is the reason why I come, he's our high priest.
Yes.
And that's what I want to speak to you about on tonight. Now, before I get ready to do that, I'm going to have to do this because I really want to kind of run through this because I want you to know that the Father and the Son is not the same. Do you hear me saying to God? Okay, Romans, the first chapter. I'm going to breeze through this now. I went through this last time, but I want to breeze through it again. Romans, the first chapter. This is Paul writing to Romans. He said, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace and peace, grace to you and peace from God our Father and who? And the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, he ain't speak. He said the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you hear me? You said, if they three different people? No, they're not three different people. They're the same, but at the same time, they have different functions.
Yes.
You got the Father, you got the Son, and you got the Holy Spirit. All of them have different functions.
Yes.
You said, well, then I can't understand it. Well, good. Because if you can understand God, he wouldn't be God.
Yes.
Do you hear me? But you created in God's image and likeness.
Yes.
You are body, spirit, and soul.
Mm-hmm.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
So we see the Father and the Son. Go to 1 Corinthians. I just want to show you that it's the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, look at Paul. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from who? The Lord Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
If Jesus was the Father, he just would have said Jesus the Father.
Yes.
But he is putting the distinction. He said the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, go to Galatians. Grace and peace be unto you from God the Father and from who? And from Jesus Christ. Okay, go to Ephesians because everything I show you, I want to show you in the Word. Okay, blessed be God the Father, the first chapter, each one on the first chapter. Blessed be God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, he said Father and the Son. Okay, they're not the same person. Do you hear me? Look at Philippians, the first chapter, the second verse. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and means there's something that's connected to this and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want you to understand that the Father and the Son, it's not like they have a different mindset, but they have different roles to play. Do you hear me? Now, we just spoke about the Father, but I want to speak about the Son tonight. And I want to speak about Jesus, your great high priest.
Yes.
They're in Romans, the 6th chapter, the 20th verse. Yes, Lord. Because he is your great high priest. Yes, Lord. He's the Son of God. You need a high priest. Because a priest is a mediator. You say, well, why do I need a high priest? A priest is a mediator. A mediator is a person who stands between two parties. A mediator or a priest is somebody who stands between two people who are having an argument with each other and having a disagreement with each other. We see in 1 Timothy, the Bible said that there is one mediator between God and man. He said the man, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Why do we need a high priest? Why do we need a priest? You got to go back to Genesis.
Yes.
Because when man and woman disobey God, and they sin against God. Guess what? God said in the day that you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you should surely die.
Yes.
They begin to die physically.
Yes.
But the word die means you will be separated from me from eternity.
Yes.
Jesus had to come to recounsel us back to God.
Yes.
But in order for sin to be forgiven, there must be the shedding of blood. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness from sin.
Yes.
Somebody got to die when people sin. Why? Because the Bible said that the wages of sin is what? It's death.
Yes.
Come on, Bible readers.
Yes.
that when a person sinned, guess what? God said, I got to kill you. Somebody got to die. Somebody's blood got to be shed. Why do the blood got to be shed? Because the Bible said that the life is in the blood. If you move a person's blood out their body, guess what? They'll die. Because the life is in the blood. And when they sin in the Garden of Eden, God said, you're separated from me. He kicked Adam and Eve out of the Garden of Eden. He said, you separated from me. And God said, the only way that you can be recounseled, he said, I got to see pure, precious, sinless blood. So what God started doing up under the old covenant, God would have them to kill a bull or a sheep or a goat. And when they shed that bull, that sheep, or that goat blood and put it on an altar, God said, just like you killing that animal, he's not going to let that animal die in your place. Do you hear me? But it took a high priest in order to sacrifice that animal before God. Do you hear me? This is where the Old Testament high priest come in at. Because I told you that a priest is a mediator. Back in the Old Testament, when you came to the altar, there would be a high priest there. And the high priest would get that sacrifice. They would kill the sacrifice. The blood would come from the sacrifice. They would put the sacrifice on the altar and burn up the sacrifice. Guess what? That burnt offering, when that animal was burnt up, God was really telling you that's what's supposed to happen to you. But God's not going to put that animal in place of you. But you needed a high priest in order to offer that sacrifice up before God. And this is what the high priest used to do. Once a year, they had a thing they called the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement was a day that the priest went into the holies of holies, and he would put the blood on a mercy seat. And once he put the blood on a mercy seat, God would forgive the nation for a whole year for their sins that they had committed. The high priest would get a bullock, because you need to be taught, saints of God. You need to know what you're talking about when you talk about the blood of Jesus. You need to know what you're talking about when you talk about Jesus is my great high priest. Yeah. See, you don't know what Jesus did for you. You don't know how much suffering that he went through for you. Do you hear me, saints of God? You got to understand that he's your great high priest. What the high priest did upon the old covenant, they would get a bull on the Day of Atonement. This is once a year. They would get a bull and kill that bull for himself first. He would get that blood and go into the holies of holies. It was a tabernacle. You had the outer court. Then you had the holy place. Inside of the holy place, you had a table of showbread. You had a lamp over here that kept burning. Then you had a curtain. You had a veil. And in front of that veil, there was a golden altar. Where the priests would get, they would get incense and put it in a pan on coals and burn it. And the smoke would go up before God and create a sweet smelling aroma inside of the tabernacle. Yes. But when you went behind that veil, it was a very thick curtain of different colors. When you went behind that veil, you would be in the holies of holies. This is where the Ark of the Covenant was at. Inside of the Ark of the Covenant was the Ten Commandments, which represented the Word of God. Yes. It was a pot of manna. It was Aaron's rod. The Ark of the Covenant represented the presence of God. The high priest was the only person who could go into the holies of holies, and he only could go in once a year. Do you hear me? If he went into the holies of holies and it wasn't the Day of Atonement, God would strike him dead. But when he went in, he had to go in with blood. Do you hear me? Because inside of the blood is the life. God said, whenever you come before my presence, I got to see blood. And the high priest will kill that bull. He will get that blood and go in for himself and his family. And he will sprinkle that blood up on the Ark of the Covenant. He will dip it 7 times with his finger. God said, dip it 7 times with your finger. And that blood will hit the mercy seat. So God can have mercy on him. He will turn around and go back out into the courtyard. He will get 2 goats. Then he will cut one of the goat's neck. He will get that blood. And he will walk back into the holies of holies. He will sprinkle that blood on the mercy seat. And when he sprinkled that blood on the mercy seat, the high priest would turn around and come back out and raise his hand, because he was telling the people, God had forgiven the whole nation for all their sins for the whole year. Do you hear me? But let me tell you something. Animal blood wasn't good enough. God said, I'm just letting you do that until Jesus comes. Because God said, if you kill a lamb, he said that lamb got to be perfect. It got to be spotless. Yes. But we know that animal blood can't really save. Yes. That was just a substitution until Jesus came. Yes. But the blood had to be pure. Yes.
Yes.
Their blood had to be precious. The Bible said in Jesus, there was neither sin, and in his mouth there was no God. Because Jesus never sinned.
Yes.
So when Jesus came to die for your sins, he came to recounsel us back to the Father.
Yes.
Since Adam and Eve had failed in the garden, Jesus said, behold, God, I come. He said, you have prepared a body for me. Do you hear me? Yes. And when Jesus came as our mediator.
Yes.
A mediator is a person who stands between two people.
Yes.
The only thing that's stopping God's judgment from getting you is your high priest, Jesus.
Yes.
This is the reason why I come. We keep talking about the blood. When God look at me, he don't need to see past Ellis.
Yes.
God don't care nothing about my title.
Yes.
God don't care nothing about how much I know. When God see me, God won't see the blood. And when you stand before God, God will have to see the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
If God don't see the blood of Jesus, guess what? You're going to be judged.
My God.
This is the reason why come Jesus came to be our mediator.
Yes.
It's Jesus who is standing between you and judgment. Because he is your great high priest.
Yes.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, a high priest, he is a mediator.
Yes.
A high priest will stand between you and God, so that judgment don't hit you.
Yes, Lord.
This is what a high priest did upon the old covenant. He was sacrificed, go in with the blood, put the blood on the mercy seat so that God's people can be forgiven.
Yes.
And this is the reason why come you keep hearing us talk about the blood.
The blood.
You said, why they said talking about the blood?
Uh-huh.
We're not just talking about no fluid. Do you hear me? Because when we say the blood, we say, well, what they talking about, fluid? Now, we're not just talking about the fluid that came out of Jesus' body. But we talking about the work that Jesus did on the cross. We talking about he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Do you hear me? I'm talking about the work of Jesus. I'm talking about he has borne all our griefs and our sorrows. I'm talking about the work of Jesus. I'm talking about when he cast out devils and raised the dead. Do you hear me? I'm talking about the work of Jesus. I'm talking about when he cleansed the leper. Do you hear me? Say, say God. I'm talking about when he healed the woman with the issue of blood and she pressed through the crowd and touched the hem of his garment. I'm talking about that same Jesus. I'm talking about Jesus who they slapped around. I'm talking about Jesus, who they pulled the beard out of his face. Do you hear me say, so God? I'm talking about for your sins. Not for his sins, but for your sins. I'm talking about Jesus, the one who they spit in their face.
My God.
I'm talking about Jesus, who they had a cat of nine tails, and they was beating his back. I'm talking about, because by his stripes, you are healed. They will beat Jesus for the stuff that you did. I'm talking about that same Jesus, who they nailed into his wrist, and nails into his feet, and stood him up on a cross. I'm talking about that same Jesus, who could have came down from the cross, but he stayed there on the cross for your sins. I'm talking about that same Jesus, who a Roman soldier got a spear and stuck it in his side, and the Bible said blood and water came out of his side. I'm talking about that same Jesus. I'm talking about the lily of the valley.
Yes.
I'm talking about the bright and morning star. I'm talking about the bread of life. I'm talking about the offspring and root of Jesse. I'm talking about the resurrection. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking about your mediator. I'm talking about the great high priest. I'm talking about Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
He's your mediator.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
You don't know what he did for you, say so God. He was beat for you. He was whipped for you. He's your great high priest.
Hallelujah.
A priest ministers from down to up.
Yes, Lord.
A prophet ministers from up to down. A prophet and a priest have different directions that they minister. A prophet will get a word from God and say, thus says the Lord. But a priest starts from the ground and comes all the way up. Why? Because a priest will make intercessions for you.
Yes.
The Bible said that Jesus is our high priest who makes intercessions for us.
Yes, Lord.
That Jesus sit on the right-hand side of God and he makes intercessions for us.
Yes, Lord.
Romans 8 chapter, the 34th verse. When you get time, you can read that. He said, who is he that condemn? It is Christ that died. Yes, rather, that is risen from the dead. Who is at the right hand of God, who also what?
Making intercessions.
He making intercessions for us. What is Jesus doing right now?
Mm-hmm.
We think that Jesus is just walking around the streets of gold.
Mm-hmm.
But the Bible said that Jesus is seated on the right hand side of God.
Yes.
Let me tell you something. When they killed Jesus, and their blood was shed, and they put him in their grave. When he got up out of their grave, he made the declaration, oh sin, where's your sting? Oh grave, where's your victory? He got up with all power, do you hear me? When he went and sat down on the right hand side of God, when he went back to heaven, he went with blood. Because before the priest could go into the holies of holies, he had to have blood. But when Jesus went up into heaven, he had his own blood.
Yes.
I'm talking about that sinless blood.
Yes.
I'm talking about that perfect blood. And then we hear the angel saying, when everybody in heaven was saying, Jesus is coming.
Jesus.
And I hear the angel saying, lift up ye head, O ye gates.
Yes.
And be lifted up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in. They said, who is the King of glory? They said, the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty and battle. Lift up your head, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty and battle.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah.
He came in with their blood.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
He walked up to the Father. He said, Father.
Yes.
He said, I'm shedding my blood for them.
Yeah, yeah,
this
yeah,
is a great high priest.
Yeah, yeah,
a great high priest ministers in prayer.
Yeah, yeah,
he said, God, I shed my blood for them. He said, God, forgive them. Do you hear me say to God?
Yes,
forgive the sins that they're doing. Forgive the murder that they're doing. Forgive the lying and the adultery and the fornication that they're doing. Do you hear me say to God? He shed his blood.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
thank you, Jesus.
Yes,
thank you, Jesus.
He's making intercession.
Oh,
yes,
God.
Whenever the adversary of your soul, Satan coming before God, he said, now God, I got a right to get them. They are outside your will. But Jesus is sitting on the right hand side of God as your lawyer. He's a lawyer who never lost a case. And when that wicked spirit come up before the Father, he said, I got a right to get running. He said, he ain't did what you're saying yet. But Jesus turned to the Father. He said, Father, look at my hands. He said, look at my feet, Father. He said, look at my side.
Yes.
He said, I shed my blood for running. Did you hear me? He said, my blood cleanses. My blood purifies. My blood sanctifies. All the saints of God, you better get up on the blood. You better stay up on the blood.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you.
Yes,
yes, Lord Jesus. Yes.
Intercessor. Yes. Jesus is sitting on the right hand side of God.
Oh, yes.
Making intercession.
Making intercession.
Intercession. You got to enter into session.
Yes.
God is having a session about you.
Oh,
what should he do? You don't even know that last week was the week you're supposed to die.
Yep.
But because of the blood, when your name came up before God, Jesus began to plead the blood. Oh, you don't know it. You didn't even know that you're supposed to die this week. But because of the blood.
Yes, sir. Yes, Lord.
Make intercession.
Yes.
Father, give them another chance. Make an intercession. Intercession means to plead. Father, please give them more time. Father, please don't let them die. Father, remember what I did on the cross. I didn't come down off the cross. I stayed on the cross. I died for all of them, oh God. Do you hear me saying to God? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, that's no pookie on the corner,
yes.
This John on Wall Street, do you hear me? Whosoever believe him should not perish, but have everlasting life, do you hear me? It does not matter what color you is. It does not matter your education. It does not matter if you was a foster child. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. There is no other name given by men whereby men must be saved. Say the name of Jesus. Oh, you got to get up under the blood stained banner of Jesus. You got to get up under the name of Jesus. All that name is above every name. And I don't care what name that you're dealing with. Just keep on crying out, Jesus.
Jesus. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Great high priest.
Yes, Lord.
Ministering from down to up.
Hallelujah.
Sending up prayers unto the Father on your behalf.
Yes,
let me show you Jesus in intercession. Jesus said, Peter.
Yes.
He said, Simon, Simon. He said, Satan. Had desire to have you, that he may shift you as weak.
Yes.
He said, Satan asked God about you. Can he test you?
Yes.
He said, with that big mouth you got.
Yes.
He said, but don't worry about it. I'll pray for you.
Yeah, pray.
He said, and when you are converted, strengthen your brethren.
Yes.
You say you're going to follow, but I pray that your faith don't fail. Do you hear me? And this is the reason why I need Jesus. Oh, saints of God, can I tell you? You might say, well, I don't know who's praying for me. But let me tell you something. You got Jesus who's sitting on the right-hand side of God making intercession for you. You say, I don't know how I got to this point. You say, I don't know how I came out that sickness. You say, I don't know how I got out that car wreck. You say, I don't know how I'm living. But you have Jesus, your great high priest, who's sitting on the right-hand side of God making intercession for you. That's the reason why when they slipped you a Mickey, you didn't die. That's the reason why you got shot in the same place where your homeboy got shot, but you still living. You was in the same car wreck with them, but guess what? You got out without a scratch. You know why? Because of the blood of Jesus. Jesus was pleading your case. Do you hear me? Jesus was calling your name. Why? Because he's a great high priest making intercession for you and I. So if you don't ever pray for pastors, it's all right. I got a great high priest, do you hear me? That's sitting down on the right hand side of God that's going to plead my case. Oh, somebody say Jesus. Just say Jesus, 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 Jesus. Come on, fill his house with his praise, says to God, do you hear me? Just keep on calling out to Jesus.
Jesus.
Your great high priest.
Yes, Lord.
That's making intercession.
Yes, Lord.
The high priest had the Urim and the Thummim. Urim means light.
Yes.
Because Jesus always brings light.
Yes.
And illumination.
Yes.
Thummim means completion.
Oh, yes.
It means perfection. Because when you come to Jesus, he always gives you a perfect and complete answer.
Yes.
But the Bible said Jesus, your high priest.
Yes.
After, my God, the order of Melchizedek. Now, we're going to deal with Melchizedek on tonight.
My God.
But he's after the order of Melchizedek. Go to Hebrews. Yes, Lord. The sixth chapter.
My God.
I want to show you what Jesus, your high priest, did for you. Yes, Lord. But he came after the order of Melchizedek.
Yes.
Look at chapter 7, verse 1. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham from returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all. Mm-hmm. Now let's stop right there because I want to do a sidebar.
Yes.
Because we got a lot of people say, well, tithes was under the old covenant.
Uh-huh.
But when we go and read the old covenant, it wasn't even put in place yet.
Uh-huh.
God had even gave Moses the law about tithes and offerings. But we see Abraham paying a tithe unto King Melchizedek. When you go read about Jacob, when Jacob was running from his brother, the Bible said Jacob told God, if you take me to my family and give me food, clothes, and a shelter, he said, bring me back to my father's house. He said, I'm going to give you a tithe of everything that I got.
Yes.
That was way before the law even was given.
Yes.
So people back then understood about the tithe. Mm-hmm. Listen, you don't even got to use the law. Just go back to the beginning.
Yes.
They was given a tithe way before God gave Moses the law.
Yes.
Abraham gave a tithe to the high priest. Melchizedek.
My God.
Somebody say sidebar.
Sidebar.
That's just a sidebar.
Mm-hmm.
Do you hear me? To whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all.
Mm-hmm.
Now look at this. This is what Melchizedek name means. I'm going here for a reason. First being interpreted, King of Righteousness.
King of Righteousness.
My God, you got to understand that Jesus is the King of Righteousness. The Bible said that his righteousness was imputed unto us. I just told you earlier, when God see you, let me tell you something, he see the blood, he don't see you, he don't see what you did in the past, but he see the righteousness of Jesus.
Yes.
The blood will cover you and cause the righteousness of Jesus to come over you.
Thank you, Jesus.
You ain't doing right to try to be righteous. You doing right because you are righteous.
Yes.
And that righteousness is imputed to you through the blood of Jesus.
Yes,
he is the King of Righteousness. This is the reason why I come saints of God, when we say that we are children of the Most High, we should try to do what's right.
Yeah.
Because Jesus is the King of Righteousness. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Yeah.
Righteousness means God's way of doing things. Do things God's way. When you do things God's way, guess what? That's righteousness before God.
Yeah.
But he is the King of Righteousness.
Yeah.
Not only is he the King of Righteousness, but the Bible says he is also the King of Peace.
King of Peace.
Yeah.
Because Melchizedek was from a city called Salem.
Uh-huh.
Salem means peace in Hebrew.
Uh-huh.
Jesus is the King of Peace.
Yeah.
The Bible says he is the Prince of Peace.
Uh-huh.
Saints of God, some of you got to get peace. Now, I should have been hitting on peace. And God should have been hitting me, having me hitting on peace. You know why? Because some of you have not caught it yet. But Jesus is the King of peace, and he's the Prince of peace. Do you hear me, Saints of God? Jesus said, peace have I given unto you. He said, not as the world give it, but as I give it. Do you hear me, Saints of God? Jesus said, if you keep your mind on me, I will keep you in perfect peace. When you keep your mind on the word of God. Because he is the Prince of peace.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, thank you, Lord.
Peace is completeness. Yes. When nothing is lacking.
Yes.
When something is lacking, you don't have full peace. When you need something from the outside to make you complete, guess what? You're not walking in peace. But when you begin to walk in peace, do you hear me say to God? That means that nothing is lacking. That there is no emptiness. If there's an emptiness down on inside your spirit, you have not really embraced Jesus as the King and Prince of Peace.
Yes.
But you got to embrace Jesus so that you can have some peace. Peace means soundness of mind. Which means that my mind is sound and healthy. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Because saints of God, some of us need a healthy mind.
Yes.
Some of us don't have no healthy mind. We got a toxic mind.
Jesus.
We have toxic thoughts about ourselves. When you go look in the mirror and your mind starts telling you all kind of filthy, nasty things about you, and you start believing it, guess what? You do not have a sound mind. But saints of God, we got to get back to a sound mind. And you can't get no sound mind if you don't embrace Jesus, who is the King and Prince of Peace. We got to get into the Word of God so you can embrace him as the Prince of Peace.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Peace means quietness.
Yes.
Some of us don't like quietness. Some of us love loudness. I got to hear something. I got to be doing something. Something got to be going on before I can feel good about myself. But let me tell you something. When you really embrace Jesus, guess what? Everything gets
yes, Lord.
Quiet.
Yes, yes.
When I came to God, everything said, shh. I got afraid.
Yes, Lord.
Cut the radio on. We need to hear some noise. Can you hear me? Because I was so used to hearing some noise. I wanted to hear the phone ringing. The phone stopped ringing. God made the phone stop ringing. What do I mean by that? People stop calling. Old friends stop calling. God said, you asking me for some peace? He said, I'm going to cut off some old friends. Do you hear me? Oh, the phone wasn't ringing. Me and Sister Adams was over the phone like this. As soon as it rings, I'm on ready for his name. You know why? Because we were so used to some noise. But when you come to Jesus, all he will give you quietness. Some of us cannot stand on quietness. Oh, we like all that racket. I got to hear some noise. Cut the radio on. Do you hear me? Cut the TV up loud. Because we like noise. But when you come to Jesus, he will give you quietness. Some of us need quietness.
Yes,
Lord.
Some of us have a storm going on right now.
Oh God.
It's not an outer storm. It's an inner storm.
Oh my God.
And when I was in the streets, when we listened to the radio, we used to call it the quiet storm. Because it's a storm that's quiet. Don't nobody around you hear it, nobody but you. It ain't noisy, it's a quiet storm. It's going on inside your spirit. You put your makeup on. You got ready for work, do you hear me? All you did, your little hair. Do you hear me, says to God? You got dressed up, you sprayed some smell good on, do you hear me? Oh, you look real nice. You stepped out the door, went to work. Hello, how you doing? Welcome to Macy's. But they don't even know that on the inside of your spirit that there's a quiet storm that's going on. Do you hear me, says to God? But you need Jesus, the Prince of Peace, so he can quiet the storm. All he is peace in the midst of the storm.
Yes, Lord.
He is the King of Peace.
Yes,
yes he is.
Peace means amends.
Yes, Lord.
Some of us can have peace till we go make some amends. Some people you got to go say you sorry to.
Yes, Lord.
When I first got saved, there were so many people I had to say I was sorry to. My wife would tell you, God said, go tell them you're sorry. God said, pick up the phone, tell them you're sorry. God said, don't be concerned about it if they're going to accept it. God said, you do what I tell you to do so you can have some peace. All some of you need to pick the phone up and say, listen, I'm sorry for what I did. I got to make some amends and I got to be at peace with myself.
Yes, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Something that the church is big on, picking up the microphone, but not picking up the telephone. We can pick up the microphone, but we can't pick up the telephone and say, listen, auntie, cousin, brother, sister, whoever it is, friend, enemy. Listen, I'm sorry for that. That's the only way peace is going to come. You got to know how to make some amends.
Yes.
Peace means to tie all parts together into a whole. Peace means farewell, and it means hello. Some of us need to be ready to say hello to our new. You ain't got it yet because you ain't happy to say hello to your new yet. You got to get ready to say hello to your new and farewell to your past before you really get some peace.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
To tie all parts together into a whole. God tie all the parts of my life together into a whole. But his name meant King of Peace. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking about your great high priest. Look at verse 3. Without father, without mother, without descendant, having neither beginning of days, nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abided a priest forever. This is the priest that abide forever. The priest upon the old covenant, all them died. But Jesus forever living, do you hear me? He didn't have a beginning of days. Go to Genesis. Genesis, the 14th chapter. Yes, Lord, because this is where I was trying to take you to about Melchizedek. Genesis, the 14th chapter. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. The 18th verse. I want you to read about King Melchizedek. And I'm going to give you a little more revelation and give you a little more steak and let your belly get fat and send you on home. Yes, Lord. Because I want you to understand about Melchizedek because he's a mystery. The Bible don't record when he was born. The Bible don't say who his mother or his father was. He just popped up out the blue.
Yes.
When Abraham was coming back from war with the kings, Melchizedek, the high priest, just popped up out the blue. Listen, the Bible don't record who his family was. That's because the Bible said that Jesus have come after the order of Melchizedek. Which means in that same succession, Jesus didn't have no beginning, and Jesus didn't have no end. Do you hear me? That's why I say, that's why he said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, after the order of Melchizedek. Look at verse 18. And Melchizedek, king of who? Salem, I just told you that, which means king of peace. This man came and brought forth bread and wine. He was the priest of the Most High God. When Abraham came back from war, guess what? Guess who came out? Melchizedek. Did nobody know who his mama or his father was? Did nobody know where he was from? But he came out with bread and wine to Abraham after he had got through fighting war. Jesus come after the order of Melchizedek. Listen to me now. He come after that order. Because when Jesus come into your life, he always bring bread and wine. Because Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Do you hear me say to God? Bread is something that sustains you. Because when Jesus come into your life, he will sustain you. He said, I am the bread of life. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. I'm just giving you words, saints of God. Do you hear me? He said, he that comes to me should never hunger. And he that believe on me should never thirst. Listen, when I came to Jesus, I stopped being hungry and I stopped being thirsty. I'm not talking about in the physical. I'm talking about in the spiritual. I tried G's, didn't feel my hunger. I tried Islam, didn't feel my hunger. Do you hear me? People try different religions because they hungering and thirsting for something. They hungering and thirsting after righteousness. They want to know the right way. They say, what is the right way? They say, we got so many religions. They say, what is the right way? But Jesus is the only prophet that stood up and said that I am the way. I am the truth. He said, if you want to know the way, he said, I am the way. He said, if you want to know the truth, he said, I am the truth. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Do you hear me? Life means Zoe life. The God kind of life. He said, I give you God kind of life. When I tried Islam, it was a lot of get down and praying. Ramadan. It was a lot of praying. Turn to the east. Turn to the west. Turn to the north. Turn to the south. It was a whole lot of rituals and rules. But I still felt bricks on my chest. I still felt burning down. I still felt like something was missing on the inside of my spirit. But when I came to Jesus, when I came to the bread of life, when I came to the bread I am, when I came to the bright morning star, star, when I came to the offspring and root of Jesse, when I came to the line of the tribe of Judah, when I came to my high priest and my mediator, when I came to my shield and my buckler and my strong tower, do you hear me say, my God? When I came to the buckler, when I came to the redeemer of my soul, when I came to the sacrifice, say, say, God, the burden just lifted off my chest. He removed the burdens. He broke the bands. He destroyed the yokes, do you hear me? He broke the chains and broke the feathers. He removed the darkness, do you hear me? Jesus,
thank you, Lord.
Is the way, the truth, and the life. My hunger left me. My thirst left me. I said, this is what I was looking for all my life. I said, I've been searching for this peace at the end of a blunt. I've been searching for this peace at the bottom of a bottle. I've been looking for this joy in 8-Ball and Bumpy Face and Tough Woody and Cabassier. I've been trying to find this joy, do you hear me? But when I came to Jesus, in his presence, in fullness of joy, do you hear me? Oh, he will give you joy, unspeakable joy. He will give you the oil of joy for the spirit of sorrow. He will give you the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Oh, he will give you joy, unspeakable joy. Out of your belly will flow rivers of living water.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
He filled me. Lord. He delivered me.
Lord.
He set me free.
Lord.
He cleansed and purified my mind and my thoughts.
Lord.
He gave me purpose, do you hear me? He gave me strength. He put healing in my body, do you hear me? Healing down inside my soul. He sanctified my soul. He pulled my feet out of the miry clay and planted my feet on a rock to stay, do you hear me? Oh, he is my rock.
Thank you, God.
Jesus. Mumbo Shonda. The Son of God, the Lamb of God. Do you hear me say to God? Oh, he is your resurrection. Do you hear me say to God? I begin to know him as resurrection power. All I was dead, but when resurrection power hit my spirit, I came alive. Do you hear me say to God? Because he got resurrection power. He brought bread and wine. Jesus is the bread of life. He's your substance. He brought wine. Wine in the Bible always represents gladness and joy. Because when Jesus comes into your life, he brings gladness and joy. Wine is an antiseptic. Do you hear me? Wine is something that they used back then to clean out wounds. They clean out the germs inside of wounds. When Jesus comes into your life, he's like an antiseptic. Do you hear me? He cleans stuff out your heart that shouldn't be there. I hear Paul telling Timothy.
Yes.
What God showed me.
Yes.
He said, Timothy, he said, have a little wine for your stomach's sake.
Yes.
Now I'm not telling you go out and drink no coffee, no wine. Because Paul said, have a little wine for your stomach's sake.
Yes.
Do you hear me? Have a little wine for your stomach's sake for its frequent infirmities.
Uh-huh.
Because Timothy used to get sick kind of in his stomach a whole lot. He said, back in this time, the water was so polluted, they used to mix wine with the water. So you hear people drinking wine in the Bible, they used to mix wine with water because it was an antiseptic. And it used to kill the germs that used to pollute the water. But Paul told Timothy, have a little wine for your stomach's sake, little man. And I told you, when Jesus the high priest come, he come bringing bread and wine. Some of us need a little bit of Jesus for our stomach's sake. For your frequent infirmities. Because you kind of sick spiritually in your stomach. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. Do you hear me? Some of us, we need to get well. Do you hear me? He said, for your frequent infirmities. One minute you're all right. The next minute, Timothy, you back clutching your stomach again. One minute you got a smile on your face. The next minute, you got a frown on your face again. One minute you up high in the spirit. You leave out the door and you back down in the dirt all over again. But he said, Timothy, have a little wine for your stomach's sake. He said, get a little joy for your stomach's sake. Do you hear me? Thanks to God. Oh, the Bible said that a merry heart.
Yes,
does good like a medicine.
Yes.
How can we walk around like we got a limit in our mouth, saints of God?
Yes.
When we put these saints of the Most High God.
Yes.
All you haven't read and got down inside his presence and experienced his joy. So have a little joy for your stomach's sake. Have a little wine for your stomach's sake. Let God clean everything out your spirit, out of your belly that's not like God, so you can receive some joy. Have a little wine for your stomach's sake.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
He brought bread and wine. To Abraham.
Yes,
Because Jesus come after the order of Melchizedek. Just like Melchizedek brought bread and wine, when Jesus come into your life, he do the same thing. He bring bread and wine. And saints of God, we need the wine of God. We need that antiseptic to clean us out. Do you hear me? He said he brought forth bread and wine. He was the priest of the Most High God. And then he blessed him and said, bless me, Abram, of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which have delivered thy enemies into thy hand. And Abraham gave him a tithe of all. Something else that Melchizedek brought to Abraham. And something else that Jesus brings into your life. The Bible said he blessed him. Whenever Jesus comes into your life, he always brings a blessing. Now when we go back to Genesis, because the first place we heard blessed, go to Genesis, the first chapter. My God, thank you, Jesus. Genesis, the first chapter. This is the first place where we hear the word blessed. Genesis, the first chapter. Because when Jesus comes into your life, he always brings the blessing. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God did what? God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. Replenish the earth, subdue it. God said, control it. He said, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over every living thing that move upon the earth. When God got to create man and woman in his image and likeness, the Bible said, God said, have dominion. God said, rule. But before they can do that, God blessed them. Bless in Hebrew means to empower. When Jesus comes into your life, he always brings empowerment to do something that you couldn't do at first. They couldn't rule, subdue, and conquer and be fruitful and multiply until, first of all, they received the blessing. And you can't walk in the things of God until, first of all, you receive the blessing. I want God's blessing upon my marriage, because if God's blessing is upon my marriage, guess what? We can make it. I want God's blessing over my home and over my children, over my community. We need the blessing of God over our schools and over our community and over our nations. Do you hear me say to God? I need the blessing of God. When Jesus comes into your life and you embrace Jesus as your great high priest, he always brings the blessing. He always brings empowerment. I need to be empowered to walk upright before God. I need to be empowered to carry out the plans of God. He blessed him, empowered to do something, to give the right to do something. God have already given you the right to be prosperous. I want to talk to you, saints of God, because some of you are so afraid. You want to take a step, but you're afraid. But God have already given you the right to take the step. He said, whatever the soles of your feet tread, God's have already given unto you. God have already given you the right to be delivered, but you need to embrace Jesus as your great high priest. God have already given you the right to walk in healing and to walk in deliverance, but you need to embrace Jesus as your great high priest. He has already spoken a blessing over you. Do you hear me say to God? You don't have to stay in darkness. You don't have to stay in fear. You don't have to stay in confusion. Jesus has already given you a right to come out of darkness, to come out of confusion, to come out of fear. He has already spoken his blessing over your life, and you have a right to come out.
Thank you, Jesus.
Y'all better get used to seeing Pastor Ellis. I can't stand him. You better get used to seeing me. Because he already gave me the right to live. Do you hear me? I should live and not die in the kind of glory of God. Why? Because God has put his blessing upon my life. You don't have to apologize. When God said, be fruitful and multiply, rule, subdue, and conquer the earth. You don't have to apologize to nobody. You don't have to walk in a room and apologize to nobody. You walk in with your shoulders squared and your head held high. You know why? Because the blessing of God is on my life, and he has empowered me. He has given me the right.
Thank you, Lord.
Some of you don't know you got the right to come out. That's why you still in. You said, it's just the way my life is. And I need to deal and work with the hand that life dealt me. The devil is a liar. You got a right to come out. You created an image and likeness of God. You are the sons of God. Do you hear me? You created in image and likeness. I don't care if you stay in a project, guess what? You still a child of God. You created in his image and likeness. The Bible says he made us kings and priests unto our God. You better get this down inside your spirit, saints of God, because I want to build up your spirit before you leave out this house, that you are more than conquerors through God who loves you. Yes. That you can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens you. That you are the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, and blessed in your coming in and blessed in your coming out, and the fruit of your body is blessed. Your children are blessed, and you hear me? Your children are inheritance from God. Do you hear me, saints of God? You ought to be up on your feet right now giving God some praise and say, God, I thank you for the blessing of God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Let me get finished with this.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
I don't see how you can sit upon a word like this and go out and still be afraid. If it were me, I'll run through the wall. Do you hear me, saints of God? Can't nothing stop me. I'm telling you, saints of God, you better get ready for 2017, because if you get in me and Sister Ellen's way, we're going to run you over in the Holy Ghost. Why? Because the blessing of God is already resting on our life. You don't believe that you're supposed to live. That's why you're hanging around graveyards, hanging around dead stuff. But you got to know that God has commanded you to live.
Yes, Jesus.
Bless means to kneel.
Yes.
It means to kneel.
Yes.
It means to bend the knee.
Yes,
because really, when God really can bless you, it's when you learn how to kneel and bend your knee.
Yes, God.
Because God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble.
Yes,
and when you learn how to walk in humility, God can release the blessing.
Oh, yes,
God can release the blessing to a prideful person. God can release a blessing to a person who won't listen to him. But all of it takes him, I'm bending my knee with expectation so I can get the blessing. Do you hear me? I want the blessing of God. This your saints of God, you need to learn how to get on the altar and bend your knee.
Yeah, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
You bend your knee, God will release the blessing.
Oh, God. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, my God.
Yes, Lord.
It means to congratulate.
Yes, Lord.
Congratulate means to express joy over. You don't believe God had even done that for you.
My God.
But when God created you in your mother's womb, you didn't hear it, but I'm telling you now. God said, congratulations.
Yes, Lord.
See, you're feeling bad about yourself. Do you hear me?
Yes.
But God formed you in your mother's womb.
Yes.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
David said, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made.
Yes.
Fearfully and wonderfully made means I'm unique.
Yes.
There's nobody like me.
Nobody.
You can't preach the way I preach. You can't walk the way I walk. You can't talk the way I talk. My fingerprint is different from yours. You know why? Because I'm unique. I'm in a class all by myself. Do you hear me, saints of God? You got to get this down inside your spirit. God created you for a reason. There is a purpose for you. When God created you in your mother's womb, God said, congratulations. God wished you well. Do you hear me? When you tell somebody, congratulations.
Yes, Lord.
It means to wish joy. Wish you joy in your endeavors.
Yes, Lord.
Congratulations.
My God.
When God formed you in the womb, God blessed them.
Yes.
He congratulated them.
Yes, Lord.
Bless means to salute.
Yes.
God saluted them.
Yes.
And God said, go be fruitful and multiply.
Yes.
Rule, subdue, and conquer the earth.
Yes, Lord.
I'm telling you tonight, saints of God, if you can receive it, the things that God spoke to you that's supposed to happen in your life, in the direction that you're getting ready to go, I got a word to you tonight. My word to you from the Lord is congratulations.
Yes, Lord.
Because you're going to succeed. Do you hear me?
Yes.
You're going to walk into things tonight. You ain't going to fail. You're going to come out of that darkness. You're going to break that addiction. Do you hear me? All that burden going to be lifted. That yoke going to be destroyed. Those fetters going to be broken. God going to open the door. God going to give you his favor. Congratulations.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm going to make it.
Thank
my
you.
Marriage going to make it.
Thank
I don't care what the naysayers are saying. I'm not concerned about what they're saying. I'm concerned about the voice of God.
Yes.
I'm concerned about the voice of Jehovah and the great I Am. And he said, congratulations. He said, my blessing rests upon you.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you,
yes,
Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
Jesus. Jesus. Yes,
coming
Lord.
Out of this situation.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
your enemy said you ain't coming out.
Yes.
But tell your enemy, congratulations.
Yes.
I'm going on in God.
Yes.
They're trying to dig up your pants, but you keep telling yourself, God told me congratulations.
Yes,
I got to keep it moving, do you hear? Yes, all I plead the blood over me and my family because Jesus is
yes,
my great high priest.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
And when the great high priest come in your life, he come through the door and say, congratulations.
Yes,
Lord.
You can do it. Behold, I stand at the door and knock.
Yes, Lord.
If any man will open,
yes.
Jesus said, I will come in unto him. He said, I will commune with him.
Yes, Lord.
And when you're communing with God,
mm-hmm.
you'll hear him say, congratulations.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
You can do it.
Thank you, Jesus.
But you need to know Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
First lady on the keyboard.
Jesus.
Yes. As your great high priest.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
You need to realize what Jesus did for you, saints of God.
Yes, hallelujah, Lord. Jesus.
When we talk about the blood, you got to understand what we're talking about.
Hallelujah,
yes,
Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
You preach to get them in.
Yes, Lord.
You teach to keep them in.
Yes, Lord.
Do you hear me, saints of God?
Yes, Lord.
When we out in the streets, we're preaching.
Yes, Lord.
When we're in the house of God, we're teaching.
Yes.
It's just some of us teach with more force. Now, I can't sit up under that kind of teaching and a person say 1 + 1 = 2, add another 1 and that's 3, take 1 away and that gives you 2. That's all right.
Yes.
But I want to be up under the kind of word that builds my spirit and charge me.
Yes, yes.
That when I leave out, I say I should not die.
Yes, Lord.
But live and declare the glory of God. That I can come out this situation.
Yes.
Do you hear me, saints of God?
Yes, Lord.
You coming out this situation.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Embrace Jesus as your great high priest.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Sister Cindy, I want